I'm going to be talking about metaprogramming and functional programming, and ideally a lot of times how we can replace a lot of the stuff that we've done traditionally for metaprogramming with more functional constructs. Kind of a background on some of the stuff that I've worked on. I actually started developing a library that mainly focused on high order functions, kind of similar to, there was a library back several, like almost 10 years ago called Boost Egg that was never accepted in Boost, but it provided a lot of these like functional adapters that seem really useful, and I started finding them useful. I started developing a more modern version of that, but as I started using more of that library, I started noticing less of a need to actually go out and use more of the traditional metaprogramming constructs. So this talk is mainly going to be talking about a lot of those areas. Some of the main areas of why a lot of traditionally people use metaprogramming, a lot of it mainly is to do compile time computations, some different types of computations, sometimes value computations. So you take in some values, you compute that value and get a resulting value at compile time for, say, for instance, constants. Type computations, you have a set of types like result of, for example, is an example of that. You know, it computes the result type, and traditionally in C++03, it used some other constructs to manually deduce the type of that. And then we also have introspection, which is kind of being able to query types their, for their structural properties to know what that is. And sometimes it's a combination of all these three. Sometimes, you know, we'll do a type computation based on some introspection and possibly another value that's given to the user. So these are all combination. Now, there are some of the new language features that happen in C++11 actually helps make some of the traditional metaprogramming a lot easier. So, for example, decal type, ideally we can actually just take a regular expression. It will actually compute whatever the result of that. That can take care of a lot of the type computations that are done traditionally in C++. Constexpr, of course, can take care of value computations and even some basic type computations. Also, template aliases takes care of a lot of stuff we do with, you know, type name, colon, colon, type everywhere. That can help make that cleaner. Also, generic lambdas are very useful as well. So, kind of a overview of what kind of the different concepts I'm going to talk about at this talk. First, I'm going to discuss dependent types and how that can help go beyond just the simple decal type constexpr limitations to do more of the metaprogramming, and a lot of that's done in the style of what's known for like Boost HANA as well. How to handle introspections, point freestyle, we'll discuss what that means, and also then we'll discuss some basic heterogeneous sequences, not necessarily defining the sequences, but how we can build algorithms easily using those sequences by combining just some higher order functions together to do that. So, first off, is dependent types. And like I mentioned before, dependent types is a lot of the style that's used with Boost HANA style programming. Also, Zach Lane and Matt Calabresi actually showed this back like 6 years ago, a way of a different style of doing metaprogramming that was kind of in the style of this dependent types, although they didn't formalize it in this way. But essentially, to go from the definition of what a dependent type is, straight from the definition of Wikipedia, it basically says a dependent type is a type whose definition depends on a value. So because we're mainly focusing on metaprogramming, which generally focuses on what's done at compile time, this value itself is generally going to be a compile time value. C++ is not powerful enough to do dependent typing over runtime values. It does not have a powerful enough type system. So generally there's two types or two examples of dependent types that that are used. There's dependent functions. A dependent function is essentially a function that takes a value and returns a type based on what that value is. That's what a dependent function is. A dependent pair is a pair that has, essentially, you look at an example of like, say, two integers, where the second value in the pair, that value is dependent on the first value in the pair. And you can actually define both of these in C++ when you're dealing with compile time values. I'm not going to focus for the basis of this talk. The pair is not really quite that interesting. I'm then going to focus on the definitions of dependent functions, right? So like to define a dependent function, ideally we could define it something like this, right? So we could say like make, right? And just a generic name here. And essentially what we do is we take this parameter, this compile time value here, and we're actually going to create a type, a different type depending on what that value is, basically, essentially. And you can, of course, extend it over, you could ideally, I don't know if this is exactly true, but you could essentially say the constructor to integral constant would be in the same vein of that make function of that. User-defined literals, such as like what BoostHanna has, an underscore C that's defined, that actually essentially takes your compile time value and return the type for the integral constant. And it's actually a much tiercer syntax than writing out the whole std integral constant, right? But the question is, why is this useful when we're doing metaprogramming? And one reason why it's useful is we can go beyond some of the limitations that happen of things that we want to do at constexpr. So we could take example of this function here. Now this is not valid C++, but essentially what happens here is what we want to do is, depending on whether this Boolean value is true or not, we want to return x or y. But x or y is two different types, t or u. So ideally, yeah, you could try to write if b return x, else return y. But this is not valid C++, even though the Boolean is a context, it could be a compile time value that's passed in it. This is not valid. Now you could write this using like a ternary operator too as well, but then what that would do is try to combine them together in some kind of common type or unifying type, which ideally you could have cases where you want them to be separate. The comment was you can use static if or constexpr if, which I'll actually show here in a minute. So, well, you can't use constexpr if defined like this, which I'll talk about that. So one way to do it is to use the integral constant. An integral constant would essentially allow for to do it currently in C++, we would basically just overload over the true type or the false type, or if you have some library that does like static if, you could do something like that as well. But this is simple enough to see. So then when they pass in true or false, we can actually now deduce whether it's type T or type U, and the type system takes care of doing that. In C++ 17, we have if constexpr. So this may be very possible. There's not a compiler that supports this yet, so I don't know for sure if it's exactly like this. But the idea is you would essentially be able to write if constexpr b, but you still have to define this as an integral constant. And what Bitrio was pointing out was he was mentioning that we could do the regular Boolean using if constexpr, but that's not actually possible. Because constexpr actually implies static. Because this if constexpr, you could look at it as declaring a local constexpr variable when you assign to it, and you can't assign from a raw Boolean doing that. So it kind of implies a static definition or compile time definition for that. So even though it's not quite as clear. So that's why we use the integral constant here to pass that in, and then you can write it in a more natural syntax in C++ 17. And we'll see another example of why this is useful, but this is especially useful like when you go and do, as an example, you want to filter a tuple based upon a predicate, right? Well, because you're going to have to compute a different type depending on what that predicate returns or not, this is kind of a simple example of where you're going to compute a different type depending on what that predicate value is. So, but even furthermore, some of the advantages of using that is also, it actually produces a more natural syntax. We just use regular function calls, constructs, and we can pass, especially if we have them all encoded in integral constants of some kind, we can just pass that all the way through naturally. We can avoid a lot of dot template disambiguation. If you're using member functions that take compile time values, they would require a dot template to try to disambiguate, which gets really ugly. Or you could do like what tuple does and do a global variable. Also, one of the nice aspects is sometimes there are expressions that you may want to express that you could solve ideally with just wrapping it. It may not be fully constexpr, the expression, but you can actually wrap it in a decal type simply to actually then solve it at compile time rather than going through a bunch of steps of metaprogramming than to try to solve it. So you can still have it expression based, and we'll actually look at an example of that. You also have better composability because now you can actually call functions that return these values and you can actually compose them all together. So we can look at an example of indexing for a tuple, right? Right now, you, like I said, you access that using the std get nt as a free function, right? If you were to access as a member, right, you would have to do this. If they provided as a member get in here, you would have to do a dot template here, and that's one of the reasons why they do it globally. But in general, C++ provides an index operator. It would be much more natural for us to be able to do that, but we can't, not even because, I mean, we can't actually pass in a template parameter to that, so we can't use the get in style even. So what we can do, so ideally what we want to do is something like this. We want to take in our integer, and basically this is kind of a setup. I'm not going to define a whole entire tuple, so in this case I'm just going to inherit from std tuple. I don't know if that's exactly valid in C++ or not, but it works for this small example here. So we have our modern tuple here, and we want to add then our index operator, for example. And we want to take an integer, basic integer here, and then we want to return this. Obviously, this doesn't work because depending on what this in returns, this could be a different type, right? So the way to do that is to use integral constants, right? We just template it on the integral constant here and then pass that integral constant into the std get. Now, as an example, we can actually call, if we make our modern tuple here, we can actually now pass in an integral constant into it, directly into the index operator to access the value. Now, writing the whole entire integral constant, like in this example here, is, and I just wrote it this way so it didn't have any dependencies, but essentially that is pretty long, right? Hannah provides the underscore C user-defined literal, and that basically converts it to this integral constant here. So you can technically write T2 underscore C. It accomplishes the same thing as well. I'm not sure what that is down there at the bottom. But all right. I think there was something else I'm going to mention with it. Oh, yeah. Okay. I know what that was supposed to be. But also, the nice thing about having this is we can actually, maybe it's not going to be an integral constant, maybe it's not going to be user-defined literal, maybe it's some function you call, right? Now you can pass that function directly into the index operator, and that value will get automatically passed on through in a very natural syntax, right? So moving on to another example where dependent typing is useful is doing like array size for struct members. And this actually, this problem actually comes from this guy's blog that he presented this problem here, which basically essentially is, you basically say, okay, I write this countOf function here that basically gives me the size of the array, right? But I'm going to make it constexpr because I want to know it at compile time. But in this case here, I've got a struct. And in this function here, I want to actually declare an array based on the size of that struct here. So I want to call countOf basic essentially on the size of that struct and use that to pass that into the array. Now this doesn't work because this is not accessing this value here for this struct is not constexpr. So when we pass it into countOf, that whole thing is not constexpr as well, so we can't do that. But the biggest problem here is the fact that countOf wasn't defined in the first place as an integral constant. If instead we wrote it to return an integral constant here instead, right? Then all we needed to do at that point, if we want to call the function, we call countOf on the member, and then we just wrap it around decal type, construct that type, and now we have a constexpr value based upon that. So using this construct, even even still, like, especially this is useful also like when using lambdas currently in C++ because they aren't constexpr. So you can't actually add the lambda directly in the decal type, but you could pass it to, it could be assigned to a variable and then passed into the decal type. That does actually work. But you still couldn't compute it because that generic lambda or that lambda itself is not constexpr currently. In C++ 17, that removes that requirement, but there's still other examples where you may run into limitations where you're, it's not really technically completely fully constexpr that it would run through, but we can use a decal type to do that. So that becomes really powerful. So ideally, that leads to some guidelines personally that I think is good when you're actually defining API points for your functions. So the guideline here is that API points return integral constants if you return constexpr values. Now, that does not, like, ideally you don't necessarily should use integral constant necessarily throughout your whole entire implementation, because sometimes you can, using the raw values, you can do while loops, for loops, and a lot of other stuff fairly easily using the raw primitives, and you can't really necessarily always do that with integral constants. But when you expose that value to the user, you should always wrap an integral constant, because that will give them the flexibility to later on pass it to another function where they can actually then later on, it could switch to a different type. You know, it could be a predicate to a tuple as well, or, you know, any kinds of examples. So it's always really good to actually expose it to an integral constant, and there's no extra overhead from doing that, because integral constants have an implicit constexpr conversion to the type itself. So as the user itself, if they're ultimately just going to use a raw primitive, they don't have to do anything to do that. Whereas to go the opposite way, they would literally have to wrap the integral constant. But this also leads to a thing of there's a bunch of underscore V classes defined in C++. And the way they're actually defined currently in C++ is they're defined as a Boolean variable. They're not defined as an integral constant. So because of that, it actually, you lose the flexibility of doing that right off the bat. Now, if you are going to provide underscore V classes, you should provide them as an integral constant, not as a Boolean. But then again, if you're doing that, you could just do why duplicate the API? You're just going to confuse users, little things like that. Secondly, I don't really see a point of doing that, because you don't even save typing. You don't, using the underscore V, you don't, I mean, literally to construct an integral constant requires two characters, open and close paren. You know, using underscore V requires two characters as well, so you don't even save typing using these things. Also, depending, like, in the way they're defined in C++, where they go out and basically call out to the actual type trait itself, it actually ends up causing extra template instantiations. So first it has to instantiate the template variable, then it instantiates the class as well. So there's an extra compile time cost to that. So it's actually best to just avoid those and just use the integral constants directly. You'll get better flexibility, more natural syntax, all the other advantages that I discussed before with dependent typing. So, all right. Now, moving on to introspection, right? And what I mean by introspection is not necessarily a full reflection type of framework, but essentially just querying the structural properties of a type. Wanting to be able to know, like, hey, does this type implement foo, or has a foo member function, or this kind of properties, does it have this member available? This is kind of the thing we're talking about, introspection. And with substitution failure and the so-called void T pattern, technically you could write something like this, right? You basically would instantiate the class, and then you would have a specialization on here, and you would use void T. I find this actually very ugly, although this is much simpler than other people have done in the past, but still, if this got more sophisticated, you want to check whether you can pass a certain member into foo, you would do nether decal vowels and all this other kind of stuff, and it becomes, there's a lot more overhead. So, I mean, it works for some basic low-level cases for when you're doing it, but overall, there's some better ways of doing it. One way is to do what I call conditional overloading. So the fit library actually provides a thing called conditional, and you can give it two functions, say f and g. And when you give it those functions, right, it essentially works like with this kind of pseudo type syntax. It basically says, oh, hey, if f is callable with these t's, go ahead and call F. Else, if G is callable with these T's, go ahead and call G. And this is actually useful because it works very different than overload resolution failure, because if F is callable, G might be callable as well, but at this point it doesn't matter. You're saying I want F to be called first, right? So that it has some very useful properties, and useful properties when you're dealing with introspection, as we'll see here. So going back to the has foo example here, one way we could define it just purely as a function, and you could later wrap this in a type trait just by wrapping this in a decal type, but we could just write two lambdas here. And to give you an example of how you could do that introspection, right, you would say the auto x for our value here, or you could do forwarding reference as well. I just used by value just for simplification, right? Then in our decal type, here first we write x.foo. And so that's going to constrain it based on whether x.foo. Ideally, we don't want to return, because we're not going to call x.foo. We don't really care what that is. So we put a comma, and we say we just want to return whatever the true type is. Now, ideally, if you're doing this really generic and you're really concerned about people overloading the comma operator for this foo, you'd actually put a void here as well. I just removed it just to keep it simple for the slides. But it's something I do want to point out just in case people are concerned with this. So essentially what this will do is this will return true type. So if this expression compiles, or it meets the constraints, is a better way of putting it, then this will return true. If it doesn't, this function's not callable at all, it'll go and try to call the next function. And this we just write as a catch-all to say, always just return the false type. So then when we pass has_foo and we pass our type into it, it will literally give us back a true type or false type, depending on whether that method is available. So that's an alternative way of doing it. So, but a lot of times when we do this, this is an example of doing a trait, is a lot of times you already have a logic in mind. You want to say, this is an example of doing it as a trait, but a lot of times you want to be able to say, okay, if it has a foo method, I'm going to call foo here and do some stuff with foo. Otherwise, I'm going to do an alternative method, right?
So has foo is a trait?
Has foo is not a trait in this. This is just a function. To make it a trait, you would just wrap this has foo in a decal type when you inherit from the class to do that.
So has foo just takes in a single argument and then it'll return true type or false type.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And the question was he was asking if has foo was a trait. And it's not a trait, it's just a function that takes a single argument and returns true type or false type. You can convert it later on to a trait if you want to, just by basically inheriting from the decal type of this result of this function, essentially. And that would work. But like I was mentioning, a lot of times what you want to do is say, okay, I want this first function. If this first function has foo, you ideally want to do some stuff with foo. Otherwise, you want to do an alternative method. So a simple example of this is a stringify method. So the standard provides the oString stream to actually take your type and write it out as a string. But it can be kind of slow for primitive types, fundamental types. But the standard also provides toString for those fundamental types as well, that can write out that's actually much faster. So ideally, maybe as a method, you want to say, okay, if I can call toString, go ahead and call the toString method first. Otherwise, fall back on calling the string stream here. And here, I'm using this macro fit returns. And essentially, it's actually putting this into the decal type itself. So what essentially, you can look at what it's saying is it's going to reduce whatever, it's going to reduce this return type, but also it's going to constrain the function based upon that expression here. So ideally, we constrain the first function, obviously, because if this toString is not callable, we want to call the next one. I also constrain the second function as well. Even though sometimes maybe you may not always consider it necessary, you could just put that into a lambda because this is the last one. But that actually helps improve composability, because just as a simple example, not to say this is necessarily a good idea, but I'll show a more sophisticated example where this would come into play. But you may want to compose it. So some libraries provided my stringify. So I want to create a serialized method. And maybe at first I want to say I want to use a string representation. If not, that I can't do a string representation of it, maybe the user will define a dot serialized method to do that, right? So since I've constrained the function for both of those, I can now compose this again using the conditional overloading. So it makes composability very nice. So kind of a more sophisticated example here, and I've done this before at my last talk, or last year, is find iterator, right? So the standard provides a std find to search your a range or a container, right? But when you're using, say, for example, associative containers, it provides its own find method that can actually search much faster. So ideally, what we want to do is use a find method when it's available, right? And so that's what this overload over here does. So it says, okay, if you can call the dot find method on the range, go ahead and use that. Otherwise, fall back and use this. Now, string in the standard library provides a find method as well, but it doesn't return back an iterator. It actually returns back integers. So we have to provide another overload for strings that basically calls the find method, and then it basically maps the index back to the iterators themselves so that we can actually have a unified find iterator interface. But if you notice here, I broke the rule I talked about before, is this function right here is not constrained, right? And this is important, and this will be important later on. So what we want to be able to do is constrain this. The difficulty of this is the fact that when we call begin and end, we have to use this using std begin, using std end here, so that we can actually look it up based on ADL lookup. And the reason why that's useful is the user may want to override begin and end globally to non-intrusively make types implement the range interface, right? So the way to do that is to provide ethyl functions to be able to do the begin and end. So in this case, I create a whole separate namespace, say, called ADL, and I bring in the std begin, std end into that namespace, right? And in this case, I call ADL begin, ADL end, but I just call it begin and end. So it will actually fall back on std begin, std end if it's available. If not, it will try to look it up in the global if the user's overridden it. If not, these functions aren't callable, right? Because I use the fit returns there to actually constrain those functions. Right, so we can actually look at how we would implement it. Now, in this case, I do a trailing decal type here because I'm not, this is not going to reach in the right iterator. This got cut off. But anyways, the beginning. So first, we constrain the begin and end here, and then we would actually return back the type of find. For that beginning end, or the type of the iterator that, that is correct, right? Yeah. So the beginning end, we constrain it here, right? And these are the iterator types, because that's what we're going to return back, the iterator, and that's what std find returns. Now, we could put find up here into the decal type as well, but right now, currently, the standard library doesn't actually have any constraints on them, so if we put find there, it'll always say find's always valid for anything you give it, right? Because it has no constraints on it currently. Now, maybe in future versions of C++, they might actually add constraints to find right now, and so it might be useful to add the find there. But for now, I didn't put it there, right? So, but one issue with this is openness, right? If people want to extend this, maybe they have another type, and they find iterators, and they have another method they want to be able to search for it. Right now, they would have to go back to my function and add an overload to this. Right? A question?
Is there a reason you didn't use your ADL begin and end in the code block itself?
I could actually use it in the code block because I copy and paste from my previous example here. I just went ahead and used the... So the question was, if there was a reason why I didn't use ADL begin, ADL end here in the code block, and I could. The problem is I just copy and paste from my previous example where I was using std begin, using std end, but it probably would be more consistent to possibly use the ADL begin, ADL end here at the bottom, right? So back to the openness, right? So this is not really open that much to be able to extend it. So what we want to be able to do is add customization points, overloads into this, right? And there's actually two areas where we can add customization points, and I call these strong and weak customization points. So at the very top of the function, I create a thing called strong find, right? And the user can actually overload that strong find function, and it will basically overload any functionality here, right? So even if it was arranged and this part was valid, you know, maybe you've got another custom string type somebody's implemented and it's returning indices instead of iterators. You could use strongfied to override that behavior, and this fine iterator would work with that, right? But down at the bottom, depending on your use case, this is not quite as common for fine iterator, but depending on what you're doing, you could actually do a weak customization point, weak fine. And basically what weak fine does, it says, okay, if none of these are valid, right, then try to call the weak fine, right? So if for some reason you overload it, but then it is a range or it has a dot find method, it'll still go through this process to try to find the best fit, right? But if it doesn't actually work out, you can actually then provide this method to actually search for an iterator. This is not quite as common with find iterator, because if most people define a container or a range that has iterator, they generally always find begin and end. There's some few rare exceptions of that, and so you could actually use weak find at that point to define that, right? So another thing, so this leads to a thing which Andre Alexandrescu has called design by introspection. And he always names things design by whatever he's using. But this actually comes from Andre Alexandrescu gave a talk at D conference about allocators called generic programming must go. And in this talk, he goes out to define the allocators. And these are slightly different than the way he did it at CPPCon. And in this way, the way he defined it in D, all allocation primitives were optional except for allocate and alignment. So things like deallocate, own, those are completely optional, because there's cases where, you know, like if you're doing a regional allocator, you may not actually deallocate the memory. Basically, when the allocator goes out of scope, that's when the memory gets deallocated, right? But ideally, what you do is you just probe it introspectively to see whether it has those members to properly implement the allocator, right? So, and I'm not going to go over the whole entire design of his allocators, but he gives an example of doing a fallback allocator, right? So you would have, these are two allocators, essentially. P stands for a primary allocator. So this is the first allocator. You're going to try to allocate it with the primary one. If that fails, it's out of memory, or for some reason it's too large to allocate, use F here, which is the fallback allocator, and it will fall back on that allocator, right? So since we're probing things introspectively, right, we want to be able to call deallocate in a way and kind of just say, you know, try to call it. If not, just it just turns into a no-op. So this is what the conditional overloading does here. Essentially, we call A dot deallocate B, and it essentially will try to call that allocate there with the block of memory. If that's not, I basically return, I do always here, which basically just turns into a no-op that always returns void, whatever parameters you give to it, right? Also, since we're calling dot owns on the member function, we can actually define a global one, and this actually helps to be able for when we want to call this introspectively, as we'll see here. So when we want to implement allocate, right, this is pretty much straightforward, straight off of Andre Alexandre's slide here, converted to C++. But essentially, we call the primary allocate. If that's a null pointer, we assume that it fails, so we go back and call the fallback allocator, right? But to do deallocate, right, we want to check to see, does the primary allocator own the memory? Then we'll try to deallocate that memory, else we'll try, then the fallback obviously owns the memory instead, and it will try to call the deallocation for this. But obviously owns is completely optional, as well as the deallocate as well. And so we're using the fit returns here, which basically is going to constrain our member function based upon whether owns is actually is a member of the allocator or not, right? And if it's not, we won't have a deallocate as well on our fallback allocator. Question?
The template parameter doesn't seem to be used.
Oh. Yeah, that should be block here. Sorry. Yeah, that should be block there. Instead. So then it would deduce the block type, actually, is what it would do here, B. And then when you put it in here, this allows for you to introspectively control whether the member is actually is actually valid or not. And this would actually basically constrain it based upon that. Then owns itself, we may want to provide owns itself in this way. I actually wrote it using the block here, right? So this one, we want to actually see if one of these, one of our allocator owns the memory, we want to return true, right? But this is only valid if we can actually query both of the allocators whether we own the memory or not, right? Or otherwise, we have no idea, right? Because if the primary only can tell us whether it owns the memory and the fallback can't, we can't really know whether we own the memory or not, right? So that's why you have to constrain it on whether both of these expressions are valid. And this can we basically essentially just constrain it based upon the usage patterns here, right? Now in Andre's talk with D, he's using static if has member with the, you know, let's see if it has an owns member, but he doesn't even check the parameters with this. This is why she checked the usage requirements just in case somebody makes an owns, you know, member and it actually takes some completely different type. So this actually works out to be much, I think, much simpler and clearer than even the D implementation, right? So moving on to point freestyle. I don't know how many people have heard of point freestyle programming here. A few people, okay. Three, I think.
Sometimes called pointless.
Oh yeah, sometimes called pointless, yeah. What point freestyle does is a style where essentially the arguments of the function are not explicitly defined, right? And we'll show an example of this. And what they mean, and this is why usually they refer to the arguments as points in the system, right? And so we get rid of those arguments or those points, and so it's completely free of this, right? And so, and essentially we can actually focus on just essentially composing functions together using higher order functions and combinators to do it rather than focusing on the arguments. And this is especially useful in C++ because a lot of times arguments can have a lot of template machinery involved with them. You know, you got to use universal references, you've got to perfect forward those possibly to another function. There's all kinds of template machinery that gets involved. So this can actually be very useful when you're actually defining this can be especially useful for with C++. Now, some people go to extreme to say everything needs to be point free, and sometimes you can get to a way of writing code, I think, that sometimes it can be quite unreadable. But being able to use it in certain steps of maybe you define certain points or arguments, and other parts you use it point free, it can actually be very useful in C++. So, kind of an example, say for instance we want to create a variac print function here, and we want to actually print each of the parameters here directly out to that, right? Now, traditionally, if you were to do this, right, you could use the recursive implementation. This is one example of this, right? So you could actually recursively, you know, do this overloading and then kind of do a head tail, print the head, and then go ahead and recursively print the tail. Another example, like what Louis gave in his talk, actually, is you can do this like pass in this sequence of stuff and put it in a special array, you know, and do all this magic metaprogramming and do it as well. But fit library actually provides what is called a biadapter. And bi does projections over the arguments, right? And it actually has two types that it can do. One, you pass in p, which is our projection here, and then when it passes in the arguments, it'll call p for each of those arguments here. And this is not technically not valid C++, ideally you can't expand it like that. But these would actually expand to each of those and actually call them in order as well. Also, another way you can project it onto a function as well. So you have your projection and you have your function, it'll expand these, each of them in order, and then call that function f, right? Now, for right now, we're not going to use, we'll actually use this form later on, but for our variac print, we can actually use this to implement the print rather than overloading it. So to do this, we can create two things, we can create two overloads. Now, you could define simple print several different ways. You could write your own lambda that does the cout thing here. I just lifted it from a placeholder expression. So essentially what this does is we're going to have cout here. This is this underscore says this is where the argument's going to be placed when you call the function. And then we have to lift the whole thing because std cout is not a regular type. And then once we have that simple print, it can also be defined as a simple lambda, one single argument kind of print function. Then once we have that, we can just put it into our biadapter, right? Once we do that, we can actually, and that's all we need to do. We don't have to do sophisticated metaprogramming or like try to do some kind of recursion over it. And we can, now that we have that, I guess I don't have an example here. I guess that's missing. Now when we call the print, like I showed in the previous example, it will print each argument. Question?
What does fitlift do
exactly? Okay, fitlift, I was going to explain this later. Lift basically takes this function and lifts it into a function object itself, right? And this is actually necessary just because the std::cout is not default constructible to be able to declare it statically. So I lift it into its own function in this case. Generally, it's used for, like, say, for instance, you have an overload set, which I'll show later on, like, say, std::max. And you want to lift that into there, you would call lift std::max, and it would lift the whole entire overload set. Possibly in the future with C++ 17, they might actually have a way of lifting overload sets. Currently, it's not possible, and so that's what the macro does. So we could actually go and extend, once we have our Verdiac print, we can actually start to extend this to see more how we can extend the point freestyle of doing it to be able to print new lines, right? Now, because I'm defining these as a static function, I'm going to actually define my new line character as an integral constant. So it's a statically defined value, right? So what I'm going to do is, for each argument that gets passed in, I also want to print an additional new line on it, right? So one way to do that is capture. Capture, and ignoring the flip here, capture onto the print would essentially, for each argument passed in, it would actually push this new line onto the first parameter of the function, right? So the new line would go into the first parameter of the function, but we don't want to print a new line before they print the value. We actually want to print it afterwards, right? So this is what the flip does. So the flip will actually flip the parameters, in this case here, so that the print, so the new line that gets captured here will actually go at the end of the print rather than at the beginning. And this then is put inside of a by to make it Verdiac, so every parameter you pass into it, it will actually print a new line.
Flip is a binary operator?
Yeah, it works for binary operators. Also, fit supports a thing called rotate, which could be used in this example as well, which essentially takes the first parameter and rotates it to the end of the Verdiac list, right? Question?
Can you explain what capture does again?
So capture, what capture does is it does a form of, I guess you could look at it as a partial application, but it's also, what it will do is when you capture this in the function, right, it first it will capture this value, and then when you call it, it will actually extend these values to the front of the function arguments. So in this case here, print, we've already defined a Verdiac print, right? But in this case here, we're going to get one argument in, right? Capture gets called when the capture here, it has a new line. So it will always call new line on the front of the print argument.
So it's putting one new line in the front, or is it dispersing new line?
Ignore the by that is Verdiac for a moment here. So whenever, if you were just to do capture, new line, print, it would essentially put a new line at the front of whatever argument you pass to it. Print is Verdiac, so you could actually put multiple parameters, and at the front of it, it would always have the new line at the front of this. In this case, we're only going to focus on doing a single argument because we're going to use the biadapter then to extend to multiple arguments, right? So this will then extend it to multiple arguments. But this puts it at the front. We don't want the print at the front. We want it at the end. So we flip the parameters here. Okay. Is that clear to everyone? Question? Yeah, the question was, does by act like a for each? So as I showed in the example, or showed in the semantics here, this is what by does. So you're going to pass in your function projection here. You're going to pass in multiple arguments of x is here. And it basically is going to work the same way as this, right? This is not exactly valid C++. But basically, it's going to call that function p on each of those arguments. So it's essentially like a for each over the arguments, right? And then this is an example of the print line. So then eventually you could say hello and then world, and then it would print hello world with a new line at the end. Another example is, like, say for instance, we want to do a variac max, right? So we want to say we can pass in multiple arguments for the max, and then it will automatically pull out whatever that maximum value is. That's just a simple example, right? Traditionally, you could implement this recursively, right? So you would, if you got a single argument, you just go ahead and return that because there's nothing to compare against. Otherwise, you call std max, and then you call the rest of the max recursively, right? And this is, but if you're using point-free style, you actually recognize that that is a fold operation, right? So C++, or if the fit library actually provides what's called a compress adapter, which I might be changing the name actually to fold in the future, but essentially that does the fold over the arguments, right? So it basically does the recursive operation. So it calls that as a binary operator on it, and then it recursively calls that on the rest of the arguments. And then for the head, if you got a single argument, it basically returns back that argument. So essentially implements the construct that I showed before, but we can actually customize it. So in this case, if we take advantage of that, we can now just lift std max here, pass it into the compress adapter, and we have our variac max function, right? So moving on to heterogeneous sequences, right? Now, and we'll actually focus on applying algorithms to that. So to do a heterogeneous sequence, the fit library provides this unpack function here, right? And what the unpack function essentially does is, here's an example of, we have check equal, it takes two arguments and returns true if they're equal, right? But what it does is when you pass in a tuple, right, it'll unpack those arguments. So each argument to the tuple gets passed in as an argument to the function, right? It actually supports both tuple, and then it actually has a, the fit library also has a thing called pack that packs it. Question?
Would this be an apply operation?
Yes. Oh, the question, would this be apply operation? It's not, it works like the std apply, right? But it's not actually, this is actually unpack. It doesn't do the function application and unpacks it before it does the apply, right? So it works exactly like std apply does. But but you can actually customize this. So it actually has a customization point. So for example, say for instance, we got a custom struct called point, and we have x, y in the point, right? We can actually use this unpack sequence struct that's provided by the fit library and specialize it for a point class here. And inside of that, we write an apply function, which is, has nothing to do with the operation that we're doing here. It's just called apply. That basically takes the point here, and we actually use this as a template so that way it works for const reference, mutable references, R value references. And then we basically take the point, we call the function, and we just call our p.x, p.y, and essentially now we can actually now unpack our check equals when we construct a point, it'll actually work for our point type, right? So this is actually very useful for heterogeneous sequences. So we can actually use this to start developing algorithms, right? So the biadapter itself, right, we can take, so when we want to do a transform, we take in a sequence and we take in a function that applies a transformation to each element in the tuple, essentially. So looking at the example here, right, we take our tuple of 1, 2, and we want to transform it, like in this example here, I'm squaring each single element, right? And when I square each single element, right, it will, the resulting tuple will actually be equal to 1 and 4, basically. So we're actually applying this transformation there. To implement that, right, Louis showed an example of implementing that in his talk, but using the function adapters, higher order functions, we can use the bi that we were talking about earlier, right? So we take the f, which is going to apply it to each single argument to the function, and we use unpack. Unpack will unpack those to make them from the tuple then to arguments so that we can use the bi adapter, right? Our resulting type, we want to actually get back a tuple. So that's why we pass in the second parameter here, which will actually construct a std tuple in this case, right? Now you notice, yeah, of course I talked about point freestyle. Of course I was showing here, you know, you have to do this perfect forwarding, which is annoying. An alternate style is the point free style of doing the same thing. So you could actually write this completely in a point free style as well. For most of the examples, I'm not going to use the point free because I think the lambda is actually much clearer. But this is just an example that you could technically write this completely point free. Yeah.
Is this forward correct? Because forward takes the whatever was the.
That should be Deckel type sequence, right?
No, Deckel type sequence. That will figure out what the type is, so they can conditionally move the sequence. Yeah. Yeah, it is correct for the perfect forwarding. Now, you know, ideally, it's confusing. You could use point free. Not as many people are familiar with the point free and all the manipulations of that, but it's very possible that you can compose your operations and get a point free style. But essentially, point free is actually, just to point out, point free is actually more useful when they use it with functional programming when you're using currying, right? So when you curry your function, right, most people are not going to want to curry it. So that's why I use this compress apply. So this apply here will actually, by doing a fold of function application over it, we can actually convert a currying function back to a function that takes arguments. And that's what this thing is doing here. And then we have to flip the parameters and do other stuff like that. But most of the examples, I'm not gonna show any of the examples using point free style, but this is just a demonstration that it's possible, right? We can also extend this to for each, right? Like as someone mentioned, the by is essentially doing a for each over arguments. We can actually unpack the by, do for each over each of the arguments as well. And ideally, we're just composing unpack with another combinator, right? We can actually combine it with compress as well and do folding as well. We can do fold over it. But let's do something more sophisticated. Let's do a tuple, right? Or a monad, I'm sorry. And since this is a functional talk, right, it wouldn't be complete without talking about a monad, right? And this is more of a polymorphic monad, right? So when you define a monad, we're going to have two functions. We're going to have tuple yield and tuple for. Tuple yield essentially is going to take our type t and put it into the tuple, right? For a tuple for, we're going to take two parameters of our tuple, and then we're going to take a function that's going to take a t, and it's going to return back a tuple of u's. The result of that is going to be a tuple of u's. And notice this uses two. This is not valid C++ syntax, so it gets a little confusing. I'll show it using the join transform, which is probably clear. But essentially, the u's is unpacks to parameter packs themselves, which we then ultimately unpack, which you can't do in C++. But that's ultimately what would be happening. So another way of looking at this, dividing this into two separate functions, is transform and join. We already defined what our transform is, right? So in the sense of our transform, we take our sequence and then we take a function that's going to map it. But our mapping function, in this case, for doing the tuple for, is we're going to return back a tuple of u's, right? And then the result, because we're going to transform each t's to a tuple of u's, we're going to have a tuple of u's, right? In this case, right? Because we have that, we actually want just the ending result of the tuple of u's that's defined here. So we can use a tuple join that takes our tuples of tuples and flattens it into one single tuple. Is basically, this is what our operation to do. We've already defined tuple transform, so we're already like halfway there to defining this. We just need to define tuple join in this case, right? So to do that, there's an interesting property, with unpack. Unpack, you can actually give it multiple tuples and it will unpack each of those into that function. So if we go back to the check equal, right, we can actually split, before we make tuple 1, 1, but we can actually split them into each separate tuples themselves and it will unpack each of those to the arguments, right? So essentially we can use that to implement our join. So first of all, we can implement tuple cat just by unpacking onto a construct tuple. So it takes a bunch of tuples and concats them into a single tuple. But join doesn't take variac tuples. It actually takes a tuple of those tuples instead. So once we have the tuple cat to implement the join, we just unpack the tuple cat on it, which basically will implement our tuple join. So now we can actually implement both of these functions, right? So we can just compose our join with the transform, like we mentioned, and our yield function is just simply a construction of tuple, right? But additionally, we can also provide like a conditional yielding for it, and this is going to be useful leading up to doing filtering for the tuples, right? So what we want to do is say, all right, if this condition is true, we want to construct a tuple with that element. Otherwise, we're going to construct an empty element. And this this becomes especially useful because when we do the join operation on those tuples, all those empty tuples will just go away, and we'll just have the single elements there. So this actually becomes really useful if we want to do filter, right? So once we have that, when we want to do tuple filter, all we need to do is call the tuple for here, called tuple yield if. We call our predicate here for our conditional, and then this is the element that will yield if that condition is true, right? So now here, when we define our filtering for our tuple, we define the make tuple, and then we return back our predicate here. And this is the important aspect, like we were talking about with dependent typing, is the fact that this is an integral constant that gets returned. We can actually control that to use the return type. If this was just a straight Boolean, even if we had constexpr lambdas, which we don't, but this still happens at compile time, even if we were doing the, even with the constexpr lambdas, we would not be able to actually write this, right? So it has to be an integral constant. So if you use isSame _v, this wouldn't work, right? So you'd have to do like a bool constant and wrap it if you needed that. But it's much easier to always use integral constants everywhere, and you have a more natural sentence. Yes?
How are you accumulating the filtered tuple elements?
How am I accumulating the filtered tuple elements?
When you are calling yield if.
So tuple four, tuple four basically is going to transform each element into a tuple itself, right? And that tuple itself, if the predicate's true, it's going to be the tuple element, otherwise it's going to be empty element. Then after it does that, the way the tuple 4 works is it's going to do a join on that. When it does a join, it basically will remove all those empty elements, and then you're left with just the tuple element. So that's how that works. So now, one more example, one last example is doing zip. Say, for instance, you want to zip two tuples together, right? One way to do that is to use what is called the combine adapter. So the combine adapter works like this. We give it an f, we give a bunch of g functions, these are functions, right? And then we give it a bunch of x parameters. Both these are the same size, right? And it will call each corresponding g with each corresponding x parameter, right? So we can actually use this to implement zip, right? But it requires a little bit of work. So first, we need to actually transform the sequence itself, each element to the sequence, to a function itself, because the combine adapter takes things as functions, right? So we take the function with this argument, and we're going to combine both of, this is a zip with. I guess it's not clear completely. Let me scroll over here. So this zip with here takes, okay, here we go. So the zip width here takes two sequences and a function f that will decide how you're going to combine each of those two functions together. So you could actually turn them into a tuple themselves, a pair. You could do some operation like a multiply for them if you want to do like a dot operation too as well. So that's the way the zip function works, right? Or this works here. So first, we're going to take the first sequence, and we're going to do a transform on it to turn it into a sequence of functions, right? And that basically takes each element of x, and we're going to return a new function that's going to take another additional element that's going to be applied from the other sequence, and we're going to call f on x and y here. Then we got to put that into the combine adapter, right? Now this requires a little manipulation that we need to unpack, because the functions here is a sequence, right? And combine takes variac arguments. So we have to use unpack to do that, right? But the first parameter to unpack is the function that we're going to use to construct the tuple. So because of that, we first have to capture the tuple first, then we unpack that and pass in the function sequence, and then it will expand those functions to the multiple arguments. Once we have that, our second sequence, so this will combine it, our second sequence is not Verdeck arguments either, it's a sequence, right? So we have to do an unpack on that, and then that will unpack the sequence there. So does that make sense to everyone? So an example of doing this essentially is we can take our two tuples here. We can, this does basically like a dot product essentially. So on these two tuples, we multiply the values between the tuples, right? So we're going to do 1 times 3, 2 times 4 here, right? And then that will give us a new sequence here. And then we're going to use our tuple fold that we defined earlier, and we're going to sum the entire operation to do like a dot product on it. And then we can sum this 1 times 3 to 4 times 2. That basically is what this is going to do. So it's going to do 1 times 3 here, 4 times 2, and it's going to sum those both together. So that's the way the zip works. So that's kind of the end of the talk. Shows the example of how you can use a lot of functional constructs and even move away from doing some of the more of the traditional metaprogramming constructs as well. Some of it is different as well, but I think in a lot of ways it actually provides much simpler interfaces overall. So any questions? Yes.
I won't judge you, but I'd like to see the definitions of the macros.
Okay, you want to see the definition of macros? Which one, macros?
Like the fit one.
Which one, the lift? Or
just a selection of them.
Okay. So the lift macro, just to kind of go over briefly, the lift macro just simply wraps whatever that expression is into a generic lambda, right? The static function, the other macros like the static function, for example, that's designed to take care of, well, it's also designed to take care of portability, but it provides it, make sure it's statically initialized so you don't have to worry about initialization or issue. It also makes sure that it's ODR friendly so that the address of that function object is the same across all translation units, so it does some work with doing that as well, and it provides portability, like when you not, because you can do it using template variables with C++ 14 because they have external linkage, but if you're using C++ 11, there's other ways you can accomplish it as well, and so that's another macro that takes care of that. The lambda function itself does that. To do the constexpr initialization, I wrote a blog post previously about it, but essentially, because the only way to actually do that, it does this ternary trick, and then it does a reinterpret cast at that point. Now, to do it, but it also makes sure that the address of that object, it still makes sure of two things as well, just like the static function. It's statically initialized at compile time, and then it has a unique address across translation units. And to do that itself, it uses, for GCC and Clang, it uses some special utilities that it provides so that you can do the reinterpret cast at compile time, which is not technically valid C++. So it does, but hopefully in C++ 17, all that, the C++ 17, all that completely goes away because we're going to have constexpr lambdas. So none of that will actually be necessary in the future. So that's the go over those macros. That's what some of that does. Question?
So just like in a nutshell, how would you compare this approach to HANA? Or are these orthogonal things?
These are very much, he was asking how this compares to HANA. These are very much like the basis of a lot of what HANA does as well. Louis talk kind of showed more on a low level of what it does. I was kind of showing more of like, hey, if we have these high level or we have these higher order functions, we can combine it together. You could take Louis talk as well and say, this is how you can implement some of those higher order functions. I don't really show how to implement them, but you could take that over instead of applying to heterogeneous sequences, like what FIT does, it applies it to just functions themselves. So, but it's very much, it very much is like a like HANA is pretty much based on the same kind of concepts. Yeah.
At the right beginning, you have this example by replacing the get function by the bracket operator.
Yeah.
If integral constant had a constexpr constructor, could you then just write 2 within the angle bracket?
Okay, the question is if it had a constexpr constructor, would that work? No, it wouldn't work because it has to be able to deduce the type. And the compiler is not going to deduce a type from a literal in the function. So that's why it has to go into an integral constant to be able to do that. So because, yeah, because the only thing, if it had the constructor, the only thing it could technically accept would be like 2, right? And it doesn't actually store any data at all. So any other questions? Yes.
I was wondering whether do you have any compile time benchmarks for the fit, like in comparison to HANA or another library?
The question was about compile time benchmarks. I have not done any comparison against the against like HANA or other benchmarks yet. I've done some benchmarking among itself to try at one point while I was optimizing some things, but I haven't really done any like sophisticated comparison yet for that. But it uses a lot of similar techniques of what is used, at least for the higher order functions, uses similar techniques of what's used in HANA.
So I used to basically do that, but then I changed because of performance issues. So I started using more, well, what I showed myself.
Okay, yeah, and Louis' comment was he used to do that. Well, the FIT library doesn't do heterogeneous sequences, right? It just focuses on the functions itself. So the examples I show for doing the heterogeneous sequence is one way approach to do it. If there's another approach that Louis showed in his talk of using the indices and then computing that, and that actually shows a little bit better performance than using that if you have really large sequences. So, any more questions? All right.